Engels and climbed up in Utrecht. And now he's a professor and chair of the physiology and physiology and medicine department at the University of Utrecht. So he'll talk to us about longer lasting TDP for SARS CoV 1, so it means where we are. CMC ABB means canine AV block dog model.
Thank you very much, Johan, and also thank you for inviting me to come to St. Louis. I really enjoyed my day, and I used this title because when I started off, and I will give you a little history, when I started off 30 years ago, I was supposed to work on triggered activity, while my promoter, Hein Wellens, is very fact-driven. And I was supposed to make an animal model in which triggered activity played an important role in such a way that we could study the animal and then translate it to the clinical situation. And now, after 32 years to come up, it's a little difficult for me in the sense, not in the sense that he did not give me the opportunity to do all this kind of research and he was supportive, but I don't like that re-entrant arrhythmias that much. Okay, University of Utrecht, the largest one in Holland. I would also say the best one in Holland. That's a difficult discussion. But we have 6,000 students on campus. And that's always, when I use it in the States, very impressive. We have 30,000 students belonging to the university. 30,000 students belonging to the college, or what you call professional schools, things like that. The hospital is located here. The children's hospital is over here. And we are located, you'll see it in a second, over there, because the animal facility is here. And this line is the medical line in the campus. And that line is the more famous line because here are all the Nobel Prize winners. We have 11. And one of them, you know. He was the first PhD student in the Department of Physiology that I'm sharing now. And this is Eindhoven. And he went, he defended his PhD, so there is still hope for the young ones, to become professor in Leiden. Before he defended his PhD, but he defended his PhD by Donters. He was a very famous Ian-Eer physiologist, and Donters had a small branch which was cardiovascular and heart. And the building that I was mentioning a moment ago to you, that is this building in which the physiology is located. So also we have to travel quite a bit every day to go back and forth to the hospital. Okay, so as I mentioned, 3 decades ago, I had to come up with a model together with my co-promoter Anton Gorgels that could make it possible to study triggered activity as at least the initiating mechanism of an arrhythmia, but possibly also for its maintenance. And in those days, there were a number of observations that were important. One was the fact that sotalol, given as a beta blocker or as an IKR blocker or the combination, to a patient that is in paroxysmal atrial fibrillation, to prevent the atrial fibrillation, could also cause all by itself ventricular arrhythmias. It prolonged the response of an IKR blocker. And I already said it once, but I will repeat it because I like it. Wellens tremendously helped me doing my research because he was an advocate of the IKR blocker to treat reentrant arrhythmias. And he was the one who made the industry aware of that possibility and in that sense made them working on those kind of drugs that eventually would help me in providing support for the theory that triggered activity was not that less frequent as many people thought. So today I will talk with you about reentry very short, which is a self-self communication problem. And I would like to look more for automaticity or triggered activity, in which it are repolarization dependent to rhythmias, and they can be based in a single setting. So what did we do is we used the AV block dog one to create or to separate sinus rhythm from ventricular activity. Two, we thought about the AV block dog because bradycardia is and was a known factor to induce dorsatoplant-like arrhythmias. We did not know at that moment that AV block is creating electrical remodeling or ventricular remodeling, and with that is increasing the susceptibility for arrhythmias. But I will come back to that in a second. But I would like to show you with this slide is the fact how we work. So in principle we have a chronic AV block dog with ventricular remodeling 3 or 4 weeks after the creation of AV block, and in that dog we put them under anesthesia. And the anesthesia is also helping us to create the substrate for arrhythmias. And what you notice here is that you have one ECG lead on the top and two monophasic exit potential catheters. One is lying in the left ventricle and the other one in the right ventricle at the endocardium. And when we infuse under these circumstances the final hit, in this case it is a class 3 antiarrhythmic or an IKR blocker like dofetilide or sotalol, we will notice in about 1 to 2 minutes that we will have the first ectopic beat coming in that picture. This is a picture of about 10 minutes, and after about 4 to 5 minutes we will have an experience like this. And this is happening in 70% of the dogs, 7-0. So the dog is very susceptible when we put all those hits together to have this kind of an arrhythmia coming.
Are you actually seeing a measurable prolongation of the APD when the first extra system comes?
Absolutely. Okay. You can see it there. This is longer than that one. Longer.
Okay.
In the same days, when I was starting off, I had a very helpful cardiologist, and he said to me, "You like to study triggered activity, and I have a woman who is coming back because she has, in principle, congenital long QT, and something is wrong with the pacemaker because she was doing well for 7 years, and I have to bring her to the catheterization room to do an electrophysiological study. Would you mind when I put in a monophasic exit potential catheter to see whether we can identify early after depolarizations?" His name is Chris de Zwaan. And I said, "Wonderful, I'll be there." So you see over here, lead 3 of the ECG, and you see the spikes. The spikes represent the pacemaker, and then you have the ventricular complex. And you notice very clearly that there are 2 spikes in the row here which are not followed. And then there are 3 again followed, and again 2 not. So in principle, by the malfunctioning of the pacemaker, it was the electrode, there is a short initiation period, and that then gets you into a dorsat-like arrhythmia. And when you look at the ECG, there is not that much, or at the monophasic exit potential, it's not that much visible under these conditions. But when you slow down the heart rate, you clearly see the humps in the monophasic exit potential, which in my opinion are still indicative for EADs. So the long QT thought paradigm was a very useful paradigm to develop the model. So in this presentation I would like to tell you more in first instance about the chronic AV block dog. Then I would like to discuss the concept of repolarization reserve, proceeding with electrical remodeling, and then I would like to go into the mechanism of drug-induced dorsat. The model. So in principle, it's very simple. We have a control condition, two ECG leads, a left ventricular motor phasing and a right ventricular motor phasing action potential. And in that circumstances, there is a certain QT time, a certain RR interval, and there is a small difference between left and right, that's only 10 milliseconds heterogeneity interventricularly. When we create AV block, you notice that there is a huge increase in the cycle length. There is not that much increase in the QT time, although the action potentials are prolonging, suggesting a relationship with the frequency. But more importantly, 3 or 4 weeks later, chronic AV block, there is a new QT time, a huge change in the repolarization dynamics, and there is an increase in the left and also in the right, but the left is much more increased than the right, creating a certain spatial dispersion between the ventricles. So this is in principle the electrical remodeling that occurs in this canine heart. That's not the only thing, because there's also structural remodeling. There's biventricular hypertrophy. And when we take an IKR blocker, which is unsafe, like a acetylcholine, we will have 3 of those arrhythmias within the 5-minute period after we start dofetilide. That's one of our quantification methodologies that we need for our definition. I will come back to that in a second. For our definition, we need to have 3 polymorphic, like tosal dependent arrhythmias, to make the dog inducible, to call him susceptible. And that has to happen in 10 minutes after the start of the infusion of dofetilide, which takes 5 minutes. As I mentioned, there is and was a lot of discussion how to define tosal dependent. And in principle also how to characterize all the different arrhythmias that we see in that 10-minute period after the start of an IKR blocker. As I mentioned, we have an ectopic beat over there, and we have a tosat-like thing over here. In our hands, it has to be at least 5 beats consecutively, but you notice that there are many of these episodes. There are short ones. There is even defibrillation. Perhaps there is a little bit more ventricular fibrillation over there. So to use the word tosat is not completely covering the whole arrhythmogenic endpoints that we see. We see much more. And you have a summary over here, how many multiple and single ectopic beats, how many tosats, how long the tosats, how many defibrillations. I mean, you can do it in a number of ways, but it is important, and I will come back to that in a second. When Paul Volders got married, I was the last one standing in the lab, and one of my biotechnicians called me down from the animal facility because one dog died. And he said, but this is the one with the telemetry device on. So this is the day of the marriage of Paul. I had to go to the church. But this was an interesting one, because of the animals in the order of 5 to 6% dies spontaneously in their cage. And when you look at the mechanism, how it appears with an increase in heart rate, short long short sequence like appearance, and a polymorphic behavior, and you may tell that you can call it a tosato, you might like to call it a polymorphic VT or a VT by itself. I mean, there is also a relationship between the susceptibility under all those conditions under anesthesia as when the dog is excited because of the technician bringing him food. That was the reason that this one died in front of the technician. So to summarize quickly the changes that occur in the animals and that relationship with arrhythmogenic endpoints, I would like to show you the sequence of weeks. So we study the dog in the order of 3 to 4 months. We can test the dog serially. So at each moment in time, we can do the testing that I have described a moment ago. But first look at the red line. This is the bradycardia. We have a reduction in heart rate of about 50% after creation of AV block. And we are going for an idioventricular rhythm that we cannot control. Cardiac output is dropping acutely too. This is the moment of AV block. But you notice that quickly the neurohumoral system is assisting the dog to survive that acute heart failure. And in time, it becomes almost back to normal again. So the dog is in principle compensated. When you look at the QT time, that is the blue line, it's clear that there's a quick increase in the length of the repolarization times, and it is maintained in all the weeks. As I mentioned, neurohumorally you notice directly an increase in contractility, in this case quantified as the pressure development in the left ventricle, but that is decreasing in time because the neurohumoral contribution is less necessary, because in yellow you see the development of the ventricular hypertrophy which takes over. So you have a number of different remodeling processes that does not influence the inducibility of TOSA. The dog is very reproducible over time, and you notice that at 2 weeks already there is a certain number of dogs over 70% responding, while without ventricular remodeling, either in sinus rhythm or in the bradycardia of the acute AV block without ventricular remodeling, the same animals, there is no induction of TOSAT possible. And then it continues. Okay. So the concept of repolarization reserve.
Can I just ask a question? So if you don't give them any drugs, are they in a stable state indefinitely like that?
4 years, they have survived. And they did everything normal.
They don't go into heart failure because of lack of reserve of some kind.
There was a paper in the early 1900s of a cardiac surgeon who made a V-block to create heart failure. But we had to give the dogs exercise additionally. So without exercise, the dog is doing fine. But when you put them on a treadmill 1 hour a day, 3 times a week, then there are a number of them who are going to fail.
And this is basically a stable 2-to-1 block of what you've induced.
It is a complete block.
Oh, and so it's just ventricular rhythm.
Yeah, just ventricular rhythm.
They don't develop. Arrhythmias from tennis.
Yeah, that showed you a moment ago. The awake animal.
With all this intervention.
Yeah. But it is only 5%.
Do you know if they're always getting the ectopic pacemaker is always the same spot?
No, there's also changing. So that's why we at this moment are looking more carefully at the altered ventricular activation. By starting to pace at different locations in the heart and see how important the bradycardia is at one side, the volume overload, and at the other side, the changed ventricular activation. Now, you know all the electrophysiology, so I'm not going into details about this part, but you notice here the building of the ECG. Sorry. And then when you look at the changes that occur in the AV block dog. Paul listed here all the different currents that were studied by him to come up with the ionic basis of electrical remodeling. And there is a number. Oh, where is it? I think I lost the slide. That's the number of currents that are affected by the AV block, and most specifically, we have a decrease in the delayed rectifier, both IKS and IKR, and we have an increase in all the calcium-related activities, including the calcium current and the sodium-calcium exchange. So it is a combination of the ways to create mechanical remodeling, increase contractility, calcium handling versus repolarization delays. So the concept of repolarization reserve, Dan Roden, he mentioned that the orderly and rapid repolarization in principle is preventing the occurrence of a number of triggered activity related arrhythmias, and that when you are going to look at an added stress when there is a reduced repolarization reserve, that combination could lead to ectopic activity. And this in principle is summarizing our thoughts, our paradigm, that when you have a drug that is increasing repolarization, it is also shown on the ECG as an increase in the QT time. And when you look at the early after depolarizations present in the cell and the ectopic beats as represented with present at the ECG level, indicating that this is the at least the starting mechanism of this kind of arrhythmias. Now, I have heard today a number of people in the audience discussing congenital long QT. I'm also interested in acquired, and in principle, I call acquired the pathology or the environmental induced increase in repolarization leading to a reduced repolarization reserve. And then I get to the paradigm that we use for that purpose. We have a certain ion channelopathy, and it can either be inherited or by disease, that will lead to a reduction in repolarization reserve, and the strength of the repolarization that is left in combination with one or a combined number of other hits is then creating the tosacral trend arrhythmia in our animals. And one of that factors that can challenge the reduced repolarization reserve is a drug. But you can also think about anesthesia, electrolytes, adrenergic activity, and bradycardia. There's a few examples. So I will come back to the electrical remodeling because I changed the slide. I did not lose the slide. It's coming. This is the slide I was looking for a moment ago, which changes do occur in the left and right ventricle of the dog when you look at specific cellular electrophysiological data. So we have, in principle, a reduction in IKR and IKS, and we have an increase in a number of calcium-related pumps, and also an increase in the sodium proton exchanger. There is a discussion still going on in what kind of relevance the connection 43 heterogeneity has. I will not go into detail today. But you notice that the ventricular remodeling or the electrical remodeling is quite complex and involves both chambers, although there is the impression that it involves a little bit more the left side versus the right.
What is the connection 43 heterogeneity is over what distance, and it's between right and left ventricle, no, apex and within, base, within, or locally?
Within one ventricle, when you take a piece of tissue and then you do the connection 43 staining.
And what is, and compared to control, how much more heterogeneity do you have?
So, I was not going into this part of the discussion, but this is a typical reentrant question.
Okay.
So when I put forward my first article to circulation for publication about the mapping experiments that I'm going to show you, and all the work that we had done at that moment, demonstrating in my opinion that most of that TOSAP is ectopic in nature, all the questions that came from the reviewers were conduction related. Because could I exclude Vien 2, not only by the fact that I did all that needle work and all the mapping of the arrhythmias, though also I had to show that the conduction in principle was not affected. So the first thing that we did is we measured conduction velocity over the heart. And that is when changed is increased. Secondly, we look at fibrosis. There is no fibrosis in this dog model in the ventricles. Thirdly, we looked at connexin 43 expression, and we noticed that the mRNA expression and also the protein expression was a little bit less in the dog with chronic AV block, but not much. But then we noticed that the connexin 43 relationship over a certain tissue slide was a little bit less abundant, so there's more connexin 43 heterogeneity in the AV block dog as in the sinus rhythm animal, and we have no clue yet whether that is contributing to arrhythmias.
Sorry, as an ignoramus, the question is about whether the actual excess beats are reentrant or whether they are simply ectopic.
No, I just asked a question about the heterogeneity, not related to
that. Let's go. Your question is come.
All right.
But that's all, can I just ask a question? So that's all based on staining.
Yeah.
So you could have some post-translation modification protein that the antibody doesn't see. Okay. And you're just saying the staining looks different. Is
right.
What you're saying. Okay.
Yeah. And we don't know how many of those connections are functional.
Yep.
Yeah, we had a rat model of aorta bending, and in that rat we had polymorph ventricular tachycardias. And they came not from ventricularization related firing, but from the fact that connection 43 heterogeneity was much higher in the rat with TAC, and that was giving us spatial dispersion, and by that maintenance of the triggered activity.
But there are specific antibodies that you can see whether the post-translational modifications are different.
Hey, I'm not interested in that.
Oh, by the way, wait. Another comment on this. This is not necessarily only related to conduction and slowing of conduction and reentry, because you know, if you have reduced coupling or increased coupling, it changes the load on cells and it influences the ability to generate triggered activity also.
Yeah.
If a cell is loaded, it's more difficult for it to generate early after the modernization as well.
So you may come to that later, but do you know what soft law does to any particular channel that so, and also did you look at the dose response of that the soft law that you when you induce the TOSAP? In my limited knowledge, I know that some drugs that if you give enough, the normal animal will develop the positive one, like a high.
I showed you a moment ago that in our animals, the same animals under sinus rhythm conditions or at acute AV block dog will not respond to these kind of drugs.
With one dose, right?
With the one dose, and the dose is clinically relevant.
Are you always giving the ectopic stimulus in the RV?
No, we never give an ectopic stimulus.
I mean, with the pace, with your pace speed?
No. So there was a different discussion.
Okay.
At this moment, I'm discussing the idioventricular rhythm.
Okay.
So the dog has a spontaneous rhythm.
Yeah, this is spontaneous.
Okay.
We're not pacing. When you start pacing, the arrhythmias will be more frequent.
Can I ask one more question before you flip this slide? You say L-type calcium window is up. Is that just an assumption based on the prolonged APD, or have you measured the calcium currents from these?
We have measured the calcium currents, and we have measured inactivation, activation curves, and then you see that they are going up.
Is the peak calcium current, is the whole thing increased, the peak current is increased as well?
A little bit, not much.
So it's mostly a shift of the overlap of the
two. Okay.
And is the whole LV considered equal here?
Yeah.
Do we have to worry about transmural or
Of course, but we did not take that too in account.
Okay, fine.
At this moment, in principle, the technicians are isolating from the left ventricle in the LAD region, which in principle is the close to the percutaneous system where also normally the IVR is generated. And in the right ventricle, they are looking at the apical region for their isolation procedure. But you are completely right because there is a huge difference.
So maybe I missed some information. This result is based on the anesthetized valve, right?
Excuse me?
Anesthetized valve.
Yeah.
So what kind of drug you use to anesthetize?
So I had a veterinarian who said to me 10 or 15 years ago, we have to stop with halotan or isoflurane, and we have to stop with pentobarbital or thiopental. You should go to one of the modern versions of anesthesia. So it cost me about 80,000 euros to demonstrate that that anesthetic regimen that we are using, and it can be pentobarbital halotane, or it could be thiopental with halothane, and nowadays we are using pentobarbital with isoflurane. Cost me 80,000 euros to show that veterinarian that that part of the anesthetic regimen was very important, because when we shifted it, it was much more difficult to induce a repeat. So now we are still allowed to use it, although they are not happy with it. I put a slide up, which we used in the past, to show that there are a number of models available that are showing you a huge variability in the way remodeling occurs. But in principle, also in the heart, transplanted hearts, you have a number of currents that are downregulated or changed. So it is one of the possible ways in the CFB drug. There are much more ways that go into a reduction of repolarization research. Then, I had a PhD student from Denmark, and he came when one of his previous PhD students left, and she left us with a very big question. The question was, we test in Siri two dosages of the sotalol, the pure IVR one. When we gave the low dose, we had an incidence of torsade, in our way of defining it, in 2 out of 8 animals. However, when we gave in a random order the higher dose, twice the clinical dose, we had an incidence of 6 out of 8 doses. So in principle, we had an increase from 25 to 75% inducibility. And all the repolarization parameters that we knew that could be relevant in that time did not show that difference in inducibility. So the QT time was prolonged similarly. The measures of spatial dispersion were prolonged similarly. There was no way to explain whether the dog with a higher dose in comparison to the same dog with a lower dose was more susceptible. So the Danish guy came along and I said to him, that's a nice data set. Use it to demonstrate what is happening. And he came up, I hope, Media Nova. Okay. Strange. That's why I was using my own computer. He came up with the discussion about temporal dysfunction. So you could look at the differences between regions, spatial, at the same beat, but you can also look at a number of beats in a row. In this case, we use 30, and look how the action potential is varying from beat to beat. Because normally, when there is no short-term variability, as in this cloud, all the beats are lying on the line of identity, because there's only 2 to 4 milliseconds difference between the one beat and the previous beat when the weight is stable. At the moment that there is going to be a cloud formation like this, there is the chance that repolarization is no longer under control, and repolarization is going to allow ectopic activity to arise. He did that for a number of drugs, and this is a one which was tested, and a 7 is a certain Dole, the company he was working for. This is dofetilide, and you clearly see that when you infuse the drug, there is an increase in short-term variability that is only seen in those circumstances that will lead eventually to torsion.
And that's measured at ACD90?
Yeah.
And there's no other changes like in early repolarization or phase 2?
So we use at this moment APD90, APD80, yeah. APD100, even QT in the ECG,
yeah.
Or activation recovery intervals are a number of ways to do it. And the sensitivity is highest in the left ventricle with this APD, monophasic action potential.
The action potential is getting longer then, so if you plotted it as a percentage of the action potential duration itself, is it still getting more variable?
So then I'm normally trying to tell my students that there is a physiological component to STV, which is the frequency-dependent component. When the action potential is prolonging because of bradycardia, there will be a slow increase in short-term variability, but the arrhythmic component is standing right on top of that. There's a huge difference between the two.
So how long do you wait? So you measure it over 30 beats, and how long after you give the drug?
You start directly.
And when you give higher dose, you get a larger STV?
Yeah. And very interesting, when you do the same animals, but now you're testing the animals under control circumstances in which torsade is not happening. First of all, you see that there's no increase in short-term variability because there is no arrhythmic endpoint. But secondly, you also notice that the baseline short-term variability is lower than after that remodeling. And we are using that now clinically to test whether we can predict those individuals more susceptible for arrhythmias versus those that are hopefully free of arrhythmic events.
Can this be detected as T-wave alternance on the ECG?
No, at this moment it's not T-wave alternance, although we have a
slight alternance, but variability, T-wave variability.
Yeah, it's possible. I mentioned that. We mentioned also QT
frequency.
Yeah. And you can also look at the cell. This is the same Dennis, a PhD student. So he was infusing a certain IKR blocker in cells that did not respond in an EAD, and the cells that did respond in an EAD, and you see the difference when he plots 20 of those beats in a row, that there's a huge variability in the cells that are going to show early after depolarizations later in time. So we have a cellular event as an EAD, and we have the in vivo event in the form of a ventricular tachycardia. Okay, so that was all introduction to bring it all together. And now we have the discussion about mechanism. As I mentioned, when we think about triggered activity, I can think about both early and delayed. I had the emphasis on early, but I cannot exclude delay. And when you think about re-entry as the perpetuation mechanism, the conduction cell-cell communication, but it's also possible that there is an influence of triggered activity for the perpetuation. I think that everybody knows how an EAD and a DAD can be created and the relevance of the calcium window current or perhaps the sodium link current for the induction of DADs or EADs. This is another drug that we tested in the years. This is ibutalite, again a specific IPL blocker. And the nice part of this slide is that you have, so you have the humps in the monophasic exit potential, and those humps are sometimes also followed by an ectopic beat in the ECG, indicating that there is some relation between the two. It's not proof, but it is giving you a hint. And also the fact that it is especially in the left ventricle that those ectopic beats arise, and not that much or not at all in the right ventricle. Okay, I am now somewhere at the end of the 90s, and there were a number of discussions going between groups about the perpetuation of TORZA. These were the groups in those days: Al-Sharif, Wolfgang Schulz, Salama, and some Japanese group, Wolfgang Schulz again, Al-Sharif, and Wolfgang Schulz again. And you can see directly that there is a difference in the perpetuation. Some of them are claiming that it is focal. Other of them are claiming that it is re-entry. But the same author can also shift in his perception. And when you look at the different methodologies that were used, in first instance you could say that has to do with the model that people are using, or with the drugs that are being used, or with the anesthesia that has been used, because there are different ways to create the TORZATs. But then at a certain moment, Al-Sharif made it quite difficult because he came with our model. He was using dofetilite and CFB drugs, and he was telling that is re-entry. So, in those days, I came up with a number of possible explanations why Christina Steiner had everything focal. And like I mentioned, this is Wolfgang Schulz, and Wolfgang Schulz was a postdoc with Al-Sharif, so they were very close to each other and they were using the same methodology. And with one it was re-entry, and with the other one it was triggered activity or focal activity. So as I mentioned, it is no longer the animal model, it is no longer the anesthesia, the drug, or additional factors like hypokalemia. So we went for a different one. It could be the way data are analyzed. What is the definition of TORZA? I mentioned it earlier, but I can tell you, when you take five papers, you will get five different definitions. Although all claim that they are looking at the polymorphic tachycardia and that they are somewhere measuring within that polymorphic part of the tachycardia. Another one is the moment of analysis, because at a certain moment I was looking at the Al-Sharif papers and I noticed that he was not looking at the polymorphic part of the tachycardia, but at more at the ventricular fibrillation part of the tachycardia. He was waiting till a certain part came that, in my opinion, was serving his purpose, being ventricular fibrillation. And of course, the software can also be important. This is the example of Steiner, and she did it at a certain moment with a V-block dog that we created in Maastricht, and then we took them to Heidelberg in Germany, and they did this kind of a test. And you notice here that there is a huge length of the polymorphic ventricular tachycardia that stops spontaneously. And she analyzed the 5th beat, the 24th and the 30th beat. And she quickly realized that there were two competing foci active, one at a higher level in the left ventricle and one more down to the apex and in a different spot in the left ventricle. So she came up with that support for focal arrhythmias being dominant in the perpetuation of the human being. Then I had a surgeon again, and he came to do the mapping experiments using needles. And to have that controversy going with the reentry people, I invited Jacques de Bakker to come and do these kind of experiments. And also Jacques was in principle a reentry guy, so when I could convince him that it was not always reentry, I already had made an important step. And Jerome Hughes-Leger, Mauro Bourassil, two PhD students, were inserting 16 needles in 4 different planes in the heart. And they were recording, for instance, the transseptal behavior of the activation recovery interval. And they were looking in sinus rhythm, and you notice clearly that there is a very nice homogeneous liberalization. When you create a V-block, just the bradycardia, the prolongation, the action potentials prolong, they become a little bit more to the right, but still it looks quite homogeneous. And when you go to the chronic AV block dog without the class 3 agent, just showing you electrical remodeling, you notice that the action potential has increased further. We are going in the colors of yellow now, but there are some spots in there that give the indication that there is heterogeneity present, spatial dispersion.
Is it random?
Excuse me?
Is it random?
Yeah.
The color is APD?
Yeah.
GT, isn't it?
The color is ARI, activation recovery. And this is one of those arrhythmias. And take attention again, this one is also self-terminating. So I told Jerome Jungsleger, I would like to have you only analyze the self-terminating ones. Do not go into any discussion about defibrillation or ventricular fibrillation or a little bit monomorphic behavior of that arrhythmia or a smaller amplitude. Keep it to the spontaneous terminating ones. And we had in those days a bad computer. He could only record about 5 seconds of the sequence. So Jerome took this when he activated the acquisition of data. And you notice already here that he looked specifically at that part, and there was a reentrant beat in between all those other beats. And when you look at the 7 beats over there, you get this example that Wim has chosen for this presentation. Standing on your... And you notice here, I hope you can see the stars, that there is a shift going on in the moment of activation. And more importantly, when we looked at the cycle length of the torsade, we could not account for about 70 to 80 milliseconds in each beat. So we lost every time 80 milliseconds of a possible reentrant loop. So Jerome and Mohamed concluded, like Schreiner has done, that it was most of the time focal in nature. I skip the conduction, but this is the increase in conduction velocity. Fibrosis and conduction, okay.
What is the model for why it goes up? Is it, why does conduction velocity go up at the cellular level, do you think? You know?
We believe that it has to do with hypertrophy. There is one other study that shows in rabbits that when you make the heart more hypertrophied, that then the conduction velocity goes up. It becomes more efficient.
Because you change the size of the cells,
right.
And also the interstitial volume. So
native on the sequence.
So there is no way to, you can do some manipulations, like entrainment or something, to see if it's
That's what they do in patients.
I did entrainment, but that's already 25 years ago with El Waldo in the lab.
And what happened to this dog
and
when you entrained
the dog did not respond on entrainment, so there was no re-entry involved. But that was not only indirect proof.
So if it's focal, it means that the one spot that's driving it is hammering away at a hell of a rate. So
yes and no.
Now,
there's one spot, but it's a competition between more spots in the heart. And to get the polymorphic behavior, that's also something Nader was doing in the sickle, you have competition between two plates. And they are a little bit out of focus.
So is it beat to beat then? It goes ping,
no,
ping,
no,
ping,
they
ping,
both ping, are contributing, but the spatial dispersion, which is in between, I will show that in a second, is then taking priority of one beat versus the other beat, which is in the next one or in the 5 radians. So that is going to have a polymorphism.
So it's the direction of I think about this.
So there is a certain focus and the beat has to be conducted.
Yeah.
But the spatial heterogeneity in between is determining, and it's also changing from beat to beat, how much of that conduction takes place.
Yeah.
And how much interference is coming from other sides. And at a certain moment, one is dominant, and you have, for instance, a positive sign in the torsa. At the other moment, the other one is dominant, and then it can become a negative sign in the torsa. So then you see that polymorphic behavior.
So do all your focal sites come from the endocardium?
No, and yes.
And
the next question will be right or left, and what is the relevance of the septum? Okay, then we have three.
Still from one beat to the next, you get it initiated more or less at one point, is what you showed.
Yeah.
And the very next beat, where is that initiated?
At a different location or at two locations which are... No, wait, I made a mistake. And so over here, it is now at the epicardium of the left. Then it moves to the endocardium of the left, but at a different location. Then there are two ones competing at the most similar time. Then it is going in this line for three beats, which is the dominant part is then coming from this one. It's going up, it's going back down to this one, and it's going down there, which was already once there. So you have the competing foci intermingling each other. And most of the time it is endocardium, and most of the time it is left ventricle.
So do you suspect the Purkinje is where it's being generated?
I was very much interested in the model of today. Where is, there is. Because the difference between Purkinje and ventricle and how that could affect arrhythmias in this.
So the endocardial ones, do they have a narrower QRS on their electrogram as opposed to the one that was epicardial?
Not that much difference.
Okay.
The conduction is not slowed down. There is still about 18 milliseconds for the QRS width, both in the sinus rhythm animal as in the chronic AV block.
How many cells are in each of those locations that will have?
When I started, we were thinking about 1 million cells in the ventricle. And nowadays I have colleagues who are mentioning, because of all the isolation procedures, especially the stem cells, they are discussing tens of millions are there in the ventricle of the dark heart.
Yeah, but each focal point to where it is.
I'm only showing you here the first activation. So I cannot say whether there are more competing ones which are coming later.
And are they coming as EADs? That's what I'm...
Whether they are EADs?
Yeah, is it competing EADs? Because
yeah,
something's got to give you the fast rate in the end.
But you have also acceleration-induced EADs. It's not only bradycardia, it's also sometimes acceleration-induced EADs. So we have the impression, but then we are going in a different direction using drugs as antiarrhythmics, indirect evidence that it has to do with the calcium outcurrent or the sodium vein. Okay.
So on your conduction velocity, is it changed in both longitudinal and transverse then?
Nele, she is in a postdoc in Ghent by, I forgot his name, the Russian computer guy who was in Utrecht before he went to Ghent. Sergei Panfilov. And this is a very talented woman who in first instance came because she would like to know more about the models, and she was trying to create the circumstances to induce Torsin de Pen in 2D or in 3D models. And she was discussing the fact that there were multiple competing protein active, but she could not exclude re-entry circuits because there was a combination, and it had to do with the heterogeneity in the repolarization result. Then Albert Dunning went one more time in a similar structure. He was using now 6 planes instead of 4, and he is using about 12 needles in both ventricles, but he was skipping here the septal needles because he had some difficult registrations there. But what he was doing, he was looking at a number of differences between needles. Of course you can look transmurally, but you can also look between two needles, or you can look between two planes, and you can look in the combination of 4 needles, 2 in one plane, 2 in the plane above, and we call that cubic dispersion. But let me show you what he was looking for instance over here. He had a dispersion in baseline between two planes, number 3 and number 2, with using the same located needle, and that dispersion goes up from 76 to 190 when the first ectopic beat starts, and it progresses further to in the order of 211 when the torsin came. So there seems to be an involvement of spatial dispersion that has a meaning for the induction of ectopic beats and torsades. And when he quantified all those data, he came up with changes in transmural, changes between two layers, vertical, changes between two needles in the same plane, horizontal, and cubic looking at 4. And you notice that from baseline it starts to increase, but it does not stop with the first ectopic beat. It becomes even larger when you combine the specific measure. So we have the thought that spatial dispersion seems to play an important role, but in this case not so much we thought for the reentrant natures, but more importantly for the initiation of the first ectopic beat. And then Nele took the software of all those past postdocs and she redefined it. And she came up with this now. She has counted the number of ectopic beats going up to 5. In principle, this is not defined as torsade because we have a minimum of 5, so that means 6 or more. So in principle, this is the first torsade. And she went further, 15, 20, and more than 20. And then also, she took into account those arrhythmias that did not stop spontaneously. So all these ones stopped spontaneously, and those 9 ones did not, needed after 15 seconds or 20 seconds defibrillation to keep the drug alive. And what she also noticed is that focal was the dominant arrhythmia in the shorter lasting torsades or ectopic beats. Reentry was start playing a role either after the focal, before the focal progresses. I can show you that in this line, because here you have the same sequence of the focal arrhythmia. Here you have the focal, reentry, focal, And when you have non-terminating ones, these lines, everything ends with re-entry. So re-entry is playing a role in this line as the dominant mechanism, and these ones over here as being part of the mechanism for continuation. And you can see how much she analyzed, 45. And about the majority was non-reentrant in nature. She's also looking for new ways to distinguish clinically whether you have to do with a focal arrhythmia versus a reentrant arrhythmia. And as I mentioned, the group 3 is the reentrant, and 1 or 2 have a predominant focal nature. And you notice then that there is a difference between the interbeat interval, and there's a difference in amplitude. In the reentry, it is lower in amplitude, and in reentry, it is shorter in interbeat interval. So perhaps in the future, we can use this kind of information in the clinical.
So when you say reentry, are you seeing a single reentrant circuit or multiple reentrants?
Both.
Okay.
We leave it open. So, I would like to conclude, a little late, because of all the questions. I think that I have shown you information that the initiating beats of torsato, how you like to define the arrhythmias that we see, are always focal. And that depending on the definition of torsato, 5 to 9, 10 to 40, or even longer, most of them are focal too. And when you have a self-terminating torsade, it ends with focal. And when you have a non-terminating torsade, it is always continued by the entry. So in principle, when focal activity prevails, the arrhythmia will stop spontaneously. 1 second. And I was thinking about a nice final slide to have a discussion about initiation, perpetuation, focal versus reentry. And then I came up with something like this, in which you have a reduced repolarization reserve. There is an increase in temporal dispersion to see the EADs, but that's an hypothesis. Increase in spatial dispersion, and then the focal can be continued in short-lasting torsade or in longer-lasting torsade, and when it is longer-lasting, re-entry becomes more and more important. And of course, I could not have done this work all by myself, but there are a number of people involved. I thank you for your attention.
So if you take this
concept, the concept of, sorry,
go ahead.
No, just to mention the concept of these temporal fluctuations reminds me of David Rosenbaum, concordant and discordant alternate.
Yeah.
It's a similar concept.
Yeah, and it has also to do with intercellular calcium handling.
Oh, there it is.
And it has to do with the relation between the calcium handling and the excipitation. But the way that we quantify it is different from the discussion about T-wave alternates.
I just want to be clear about focal, reentrant, focal.
Yeah.
Because even if it's always reentrant, by definition, the last beat's focal because it doesn't keep going. But what I think you're showing, I want to be sure that I looked at it right. Yeah. There are multiple beats that are focal.
Yeah.
At the end, always. The end. Right?
So you have the beats are standing over there. So over here, it is only three beats or two beats. And over here, you go up to 7 or 8, and there, this is always 3 or 4 beats at the end. That's a nice slide.
Very nice slide. Which is about the same number as what it takes to get into re-entry at the, once it's going to go into re-entry. But actually, that's interesting that you have a bunch that are go much longer without going into re-entry, and the ones that go into re-entry always go in within the first 3 or 4 beats.
Yep.
So if you paste this dog, what happens when you paste this dog rapidly?
That was a different one. So I have two questions now. One, when we started off, or when I started off with the model, I was using the low concentration of D-sertoline. And I hardly had any spontaneous tonsillectomy. I had to change the frequency, and it doesn't matter how I was changing the frequency. I didn't have to have short, long, short. I only had to have an increase in weight, and then the EADs, or the EAD-like appearances in the monophase action potential, came along, and you could induce tonsillectomy by pacing. Nowadays, we are more interested in the continuous activation by pacing the dog chronically in time and see how a different pacing site, which is giving hopefully a more homogeneous remodeling over the heart, is activating the prorhythmic, or is influencing the prorhythmic response.
And one last question, in the reentrant phase there in that right side of your diagram, do you have a excitable gap? Using the AR or something like that?
Yeah, yeah.
Because then you should be able to train or do something.
I knew that that was the question behind it. But as I mentioned...
You stand up for Al Walton.
Yeah, but listen, when you take the definition that we normally take, more than 5 ectopic beats is tonsillectomy. Then this whole line is tonsillectomy. And I do agree, when we would have paced in non-terminating ones, then we should have had the possibility of entwinement. But we were not that lucky. We did not entwine them.
So why was the faster rates able to induce at the low concentrations as opposed to the shorter cycle?
And that has to do with what I mentioned a moment ago, acceleration-induced early after the paralysis.
But isn't that thought to be also norepinephrine-induced, not just, because that does other things. So it's, without taking the catecholamine part, you're just pacing. So mechanism?
This is, in principle, a dog model for IKR, and not a dog model for IKS. And with IKS, you would expect the isoproteranol or the catecholaminergic relation. This is more the bradycardia, in which I then suddenly increase heart rate. But to a physiological level, I'm not going in a very fast heart rate. It's just 8 times 600 milliseconds.
So then it happens at the beginning of the cycle? Like
directly. Okay. The second or the third beat is going already with ectopics.
So I still don't understand. So you have a high dosage and you see the variation
becomes
increase.
Yeah.
So what is the basis of that, and why that increase will give you tonsillectomy?
So we are looking for the stability of the repolarization strength. How easy has the heart itself to control repolarization? And when the heart is going to allow you differences in action potential duration from beat to beat, that repolarization is no longer under complete control. And we believe that that temporal dispersion is preceding, in our hands, the early after repolarization, what you see in cells. And that will follow by ectopic beats, and that can have give everything that we have mentioned.
So is that the...
So it is an indicator. Yeah. It doesn't have to be a causal relation between the two.
But does that indicator is the manifestation of the decreased IKR? And so why is changing instead of a steady increasing of the?
It could be the underlying mechanism could be calcium.
That's what I was wondering. Is it? Do you think it's calcium?
Because the calcium recovery time is much longer than those things, so it could be calcium over, the whole beat, still not completely recovered, and then the next beat will be more recovered. It's possible, that has to be proven, but calcium is, I think, probably plays an important
part. Reactivation of calcium.
Or how about the reactivation of the ITS?
Too fast, maybe. But calcium is the slowest process from all of these processes.
Have you tried putting calcium channel blockers?
Yeah.
Excuse me?
Calcium channel blockers can come in.
They are working best. And the sodium, the specific sodium beta blockers also work. Those are the most effective drugs that we use. And we can even have that kind of block in the sodium beta or calcium out together with IGR block. Still the drug is then being anti-rhythmic and not tolerant.
Have you ever tried finasteride?
No. My PhD was on flunarizine.
Where was my?
Flunarizine.
Oh, flunarizine.
That's an anti-epileptic and neurologic calcium drug.
Did that work?
Best.
Huh. Okay. Any other questions or comments?
We're done.
Thank you very much.